No servant can serve two masters. No servant can serve two masters. How many of you have tried to serve two masters? The spouse and who else? Some of you have. How many of you say, oh no, I don't want to, I've never served two masters? I'm going to see this movie, hard to pull teeth here today. So let me move on. No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. Cannot serve God and money. Do you notice the word here? You cannot. It's not that you shouldn't. That's true also. But you cannot serve both money and God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. And we ask that you could allow that word to penetrate our hearts so that we leave no doubt about whom we are serving. Let us be thankful to those people in our lives who challenge us to give up serving money and serving the world interested in only serving you. And Lord, we cannot do that on our own. We may try, we may even succeed on a short-term basis, but we know that we can only love you completely because of the love that you have given to each of us. In your name we pray. Amen. Luther left very little doubt most of the time about what he was talking about. He wasn't afraid to take a stand, as we know from many of the books that are sold, Here I Stand. If you haven't read that book, it's one of the most wonderful, challenging books that you can pick up and read. Luther wasn't afraid to tell the Pope what he thought, and he wasn't afraid to tell his congregation what he thought. And in that vein, he on one occasion said that the Christian experiences three different conversions. The first conversion is the conversion of the heart. Every Christian needs to change the heart. Remember, we talked about it a few Sundays ago, where we talked about the fact that in our lives, we, as people of God, have to think differently and act accordingly. We should not take our cues from the world. We should not take our cues from our neighbors. We shouldn't even take our cues from our family. We should take only one cue, and that must be from the Scripture. And so he said, you must have your heart converted. And second of all, you need to convert your mind. It's so easy for us today to talk about all the different intelligence. We even talk about artificial intelligence. But there's a wonderful passage in the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians where Paul talks about the fact that we need to allow our minds to be changed. We need to pick up, so to speak, all of the messages that we receive from the world and set them aside and focus only on Scripture. And if we do that, then we are on our way to having our minds converted. And then he said there's a third conversion. And that's more difficult than the first one. It's more difficult than the second one. It's the most difficult conversion that any of us as Christians will ever experience. And that is the change in our giving, the change in our purse. We have to have our money bags converted. And that's the hardest thing, because most of the time when we talk about money, we talk about a subject that we think nobody else has any business knowing about. Most of the people that I've talked to in years and years have suggested to me that whenever I preach about money, I'm no longer preaching, I'm meddling. It's probably experienced that way by you as well. But God leaves no doubt in the words of Jesus that we not only have to have a conversion of our hearts, of our minds, but also of our conscience. But what is so important about the conversion of our conscience? And that's where the 16th chapter comes in. You see, the 16th chapter basically tells us that it is true that we as individuals, as members of this congregation, as members of our Christian community, that we have to understand that there is a basic change of mind that has to occur in our lives in order to give meat, in order to give meaning to the suggestion that we need to convert our hearts, minds, and money. And that is, we no longer can establish ourselves as owners of anything. Scripture tells us again and again and again that we cannot, we should not, and we cannot act as if we were owners, because we are actually stewards. We're not owners. God has given whatever we have to us for a purpose that goes beyond our own wishes and our own desires. The steward in this particular case, the manager, got himself into trouble when he acted as if he were the person whom everyone should listen to. He got himself into trouble when he acted as if he were the owner and no longer the steward of God's money or his master's money. It's important for you and me to understand that we, as we live our lives here in this community, have one task that's been given to us: to reconcile with God and to reconcile with our neighbor, and to use all of the gifts and talents that we have in order to save our neighbor and to glorify God. That's our task. Our task as a church is to glorify God and to save our neighbor, to give him the good news of the gospel. So we are not owners, we are stewards. You know, it's true that we sometimes feel that we own something. I own a car, but I don't own the parsonage. It used to be that we owned a house, some land in Delaware County. But you know what struck me as I was reflecting on this passage? What struck me is that if we're honest with ourselves, ownership doesn't really mean all that much. Even while we're still alive, we actually already have people making claims on us for the money that we have, for the property that we supposedly own. It's impossible for us to ever live our lives without recognizing that we do not have complete control over our lives, over our money, but that there are many people. You know, how many of you have owned a home? Perhaps many of you are now owners, but one-time were owners. How many of you have had the experience that you didn't own the property, the bank did, and every month it went, and you had to pay a certain amount of interest or a certain amount of principal? It's one simple little indication that we are not the owners. We may act as if we were. We may even fool other people as if we were, but we're not going to fool the bank for long, and we're not going to fool Jesus ever. The fact of the matter is that if that doesn't convince you, then there is one other reality that we need to take into consideration. Sooner or later, all of us will have to acknowledge that we do not have control over our own money. And that moment will come, invariably, inevitably, when you die. At that moment, if you haven't thought about it before, you will realize that you are not the owner of any wealth, that God is the only owner. Now, I'm not suggesting that we hurry up that process, but I am suggesting that it's important for us to acknowledge that we are not the owners, but that we are the stewards, and that God has given us this land, our gifts, our money, our property, our friends. He's given those to us for a purpose. And we'll talk about that purpose in just a moment. The second thing that we find in this text is not only that God is the owner and we are the stewards, but we also find a recognition that we have this manager here who's gotten himself into trouble. Now, in so many words, he's a crook. He stole from his master, acting as if it were his own. And here he is being told that he's okay with what he's doing is okay. Let me start it over in a different way. The steward, in this case, the manager, being a crook, finds himself accused that he's not managing his master's money very well. In fact, he is so bad about it that his fellow workers are suggesting that they fire him. And when the master gets wind of this, he calls in the manager and says, hey, I want an accounting from you, and then it's out of here, you're gone. And he leaves the master to gather all the information that's necessary for an accounting. And he says to himself, you know, I'm in deep duty. Why? Because I don't know how to make money. I don't know how to dig ditches. I have never done an honest day of work in my life. What am I going to do? I can't beg. That would be so embarrassing. My family wouldn't really like that. And then he comes up with a plan. He comes up with a plan where the steward basically calls in the debtors of the master. And as an example that is given here, the debtor is confronted by the manager. And the manager says to the debtor, hey, you know what? I have a deal. I have a deal for you. You know, how much money do you owe your master? And the person says, well, I owe him about 100 gallons of olive oil. That's a lot. He said, I'll tell you what, strike out 100 and put in 50. And so he goes to the next one, and it's the debtor, and he says, how much do you owe the debtor, the master? He says, well, about 100 bushels of wheat. I'll tell you what, reduce that to 80. And then he said, maybe if we can go along this route, maybe the people that I am putting ahead of the master, the people whom I'm helping achieve the master, will knowingly, when the time comes, and I no longer have a job, take me in. They'll be friendly. They'll be friendly to me because I have been helpful to them. Never mind that he is taking it again, acting as if he owned it with the master. But what happens? Well, instead of the master saying, man, oh man, I thought you were worse than I thought. Go to hell. Ooh, go to hell. Because he misses the master. But he doesn't do that, does he? The master doesn't do that. Remember, think differently and act accordingly. For some reason or another, the master doesn't do it because he recognizes that a point needs to be made, that his disciples need to understand something, and what they need to understand is that the people in the world who are shrewd as can be, they know how to make money and meet their goals and do the things that they want to do in this world. And if they can do it, what is it about us Christians that prevents us from doing it? Stop. Stop doing what prevent or to believe what stops us from actually meeting our goals as Christians. What are our goals? What are your goals? What are my goals for this congregation? What are Christ's goals for this congregation? Can we honestly sit down together and say, you know what, this is my goal, and I'm going to take a lesson from this shrewd man, from this shrewd manager, and manage my wealth in a way that will allow me to enter, to live a Christian life, and to enter into heaven. Not a bad deal. The master recognizes his talents, the talents of the manager. The manager goes on and has a happy life, presumably. I doubt it, because most people who focus on money sooner or later stop having a happy life. Then we continue. Not only is he supposed to be a steward rather than an owner, who's also supposed to be a real manager, a steward, who's willing to use his shrewdness. You see, Jesus does not commend the manager for his dishonesty. He commends him for his shrewdness. And we should be shrewd as well in order to gain the kingdom of God. But remember what Jesus said in another context, almost the same context this year? Jesus says, you know, first seek the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you. Get your priorities straight. And then Jesus says, there's one more thing here. One who is faithful in very little is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in very little is also dishonest in much. And he goes on to say that we are being tested. Money is a test of our integrity. And it's also a test of our commitment. If we are not committed to God, we're going to have trouble giving whatever we ask to give or whatever God prompts us to give. Very important. If you're honest and careful, we're totally turning into mush if you recognize the order of priorities. The order of priorities is being first of all a steward, not a owner, being second of all shrewd, and third of all being recognizing that you have very little. You know, one of my favorite movies, I watch this movie every time it comes on, I try to, The Gladiator. How many of you have seen The Gladiator? One, two. How many of you think it's a great movie? One, two, three people. That's a short. Well, I think it's a great movie because Russell Crowe, who plays General Maximus, and unfortunately, he is marshaling his troops in order to take on the German barbarians. And he's gathering all of the troops together, and as he's on his horse riding by the troops, one direction, other direction, he yells out with a loud voice several times, "What we do here in life will echo in eternity. What we do here in life will echo." You see, that's what this text is also telling us. We must recognize that what we do here will have an impact in our lives and in our eternity. I'm not talking about salvation. I'm talking about the way we live our life and the way we live in heaven in eternity. But there's one other summarizing point. No servant can serve two masters. Is that true? True that you can't serve the master? How many of you have tried? Come on, you're more honest than that. How many of you have tried to serve two masters? Slowly, hands everybody to this. Yes, I've tried to serve two masters far too often and faithless. But why can't we serve two masters? Why can't we serve? You can't serve two masters because God and money are at opposite ends of the spectrum. Now, note please, it's not important for us to acknowledge that we cannot serve two masters because they are so different. We cannot serve two masters because money so often is mistaken for deity. You cannot serve two masters because it's so similar, money is so similar to deity, to God. What do we call our dollar? What's the dollar? Almighty God. Begin to see how our language has picked up the very notion that we're talking about, that the Almighty Dollar is an Almighty Dollar. So similar to what deity and what God is all about. Or you have other statements that you make. If I ask you, Mark, what are you worth? What's your worth? What do we immediately think of? Unless we have ever been prompted. We immediately think of the fact of how much money we have, what our balance sheet is. We have already interpreted value and worth in terms of the money that we have. And so it goes on and on and on, and we begin to recognize that in fact we cannot serve God and cannot serve the Almighty God because they are so similar. They buy us freedom, but we've already seen that in fact money does not buy us freedom. It buys us a new captivity owned by the bank and by other people, of our people who inherit it. There is a wonderful story about a man named Fuller. Have you heard of that name? Have you heard of Habitat for Humanity? Habitat for Humanity was a program that was started by President Carter in the 70s, and Millard Fuller was actually the head of the project, and they were building low-cost housing for people who did not have any housing provided. They were building, house after house. We participated in a very small way in Delaware in a house habitat for humanity. It was a great program. And Miller Ford, on one occasion, when he was speaking, in fact, he did it more often than this once, when he was speaking, Miller Ford used to ask the congregation that he was speaking to the following question. He said, is there a house that you built which is so big that in the eyes of God it would be sin? Is there something in your life that is so important, that is so big, that in the eyes of God it is what? It is a sin. And I asked Karen, I said, how would you answer that question? Now, when is the house so big that it would be sin? And her answer was, she said, when it depends on what you're using it for. And as always, Karen says something like that, I get off my pants and I write it down. And in this particular case, she has a point. The point is that sin comes in depending upon what we use or not. God has given us the money that we have. God has given us the possessions that we have. God has given us all of these things for one purpose, and that is one eternal purpose, to be there for other people, and to be there for the kingdom purposes. To be there for kingdom people and kingdom purposes. We do it all, but we can also do it more.